Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Christ Community Church this morning. And God's given us a beautiful morning to come and worship together. I forgot to send out a reminder that it is Communion Sunday, and you should be prepared at home to commune with us. The beauty of it is you can just put it on pause and go and get your stuff if you've forgotten. We just sent Beth back to say, hey, Beth, we forgot it's communion today. And so Beth has gotten our stuff ready for us, so we're ready for everything. And we're just glad today to have our long-distance tech support, Nicholas and Jackie and their family, with us up for a special weekend. So we're glad to have you folks from nice, cool, balmy South Carolina, where the ocean breeze goes all the way to the inner parts of the state, right? No. Oh, my. Let's worship together with number 56, To God Be the Glory. Let's stand and sing. Father, we praise and thank you this morning that this, the Lord's Day, we awoke in a nation of freedom. Freedom to exercise religion. Freedom to worship God as we see fit. And Lord, we see what your word says, and we desire to come and worship in spirit and in truth. Thy word is truth. So we pray, Lord, that you might minister to each one of us here and those logging in with us and sharing with us online. Father, unite us in heart and mind and spirit, and let the fellowship of your Holy Spirit be evident throughout. Allow us, God, to glorify you with all that is said, all that is done, every bit of the preaching, the praying, the singing. Lord, make it work together to exalt and honor Jesus Christ, our great God and Savior. We pray it in his name. Amen. Let's turn over to number 100. Thou art worthy. This is a song that we're singing directly to the Lord. Some songs are about the Lord, and some are to the Lord. And this is the latter. On the back page of your bulletin, you'll find the lyrics to our next song. The ones that we've just sung have had a little bit of age on them. This is a much newer song, but the lyrics are taken out of the book of Psalms. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Worship his holy name. I love to go to prayer on the heels of a song like that. The God who is holy, who is over all and above all, commands us to draw near with full assurance of faith, to not be afraid, to bring what to us even seems small and know that he desires to know it all. And the beautiful thing is you realize you're never telling God anything he doesn't know. And sometimes you're telling him things that you think you know, but he knows better. And so the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings that we don't understand, but helps us to pray better than we're able. And so we're going to go to the Lord with that. A couple of things that have come to light that are not in the bulletin. I sent out word that our Kim has broken her foot. She was carrying something to the car in the campground, and not sure if she hit a hole, tripped over a branch or something, but her ankle rolled and her foot went snap. And so she is laid up, and we want to pray for our sister. It's still blessed. We heard her voice and heard her music this morning, but she is at home, I think, with her leg lifted up. And so we want to pray for Kim. We also want to keep Jackie's mom in prayer, thanking the Lord that she knows the Lord and thought that maybe she was about to go home, but she's still here. And so Jackie and the boys are going to be able to visit with her for a couple of weeks while Nicholas goes home and works. Isn't that a wonderful arrangement? So we want to pray for her and for that family. So let's join our hearts together, shall we? Well, Father, it is a great privilege to come to you in prayer and begin with Father. We're not saying, "Oh, most holy Lord and awesome, terrible, dread master." We're saying, "Daddy." And the truth is, you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But you invite us near, not in terror, but in love and friendship and fatherhood through the blood of Christ, which has joined us to your family. And so, God, what a blessed people we are. We live in a nation that has won freedom, and that as your gift, God, and it cost blood and sweat and tears, Lord, of a much earlier generation, and then those subsequent to maintain it. And here we are, Father, still reaping the blessing and the benefit. People wondered, Lord, what will they do with their freedom? I thank you, God, that one thing that we are still able to do is worship you with that freedom and proclaim the name of Christ and share the gospel with that freedom. Lord, that may not always be the case, but today it is. And your church thanks you and asks, God, help us to use such gift of independence and a constitution and a bill of rights with great wisdom and with thankful hearts, Lord. Though some use it for evil, help your people use it for good. And I thank you, God, that this very morning we are meeting without fear, without intimidation, and as far as we know, without government fact checkers about to rip apart my sermon. Father, we thank you for your word, which is truth and pierces thoughts and motivations of the heart. We invite you to do that this morning, Lord. We invite you to break up the hard places in our own hearts and open our minds that sometimes get foggy with sin and insensitive, Lord, with eyes that are blinded with our own folly and ears, Lord, that become deaf. Lord, reawaken and refresh us as our desire is to end up communing with you. And we invite you to work in our lives, Lord, and we honestly have no idea eventually who will listen and hear these words, but we pray, God, that they would have great effect, every part. But we invite you to begin with us, Lord. Refresh and prepare us for the work you have ahead of us, Lord, even this very week. We pray you would go with Jackie and the boys to Minnesota. We pray, God, that their visit would be an encouragement to all. We pray your hand rest upon your servant there sick. And Lord, we know full well that when you desire to take your children home, we go home. Not one second early and not one second late. But until then, Lord, we pray great grace, the healing and strengthening touch. We pray, Lord, the same for our sister Kim. We're thanking you, Lord, that we still have a gift of music that we are able to use. And bless you for technology, Lord, that makes it possible. But we pray you lift up our sister, Lord. Make her ankle and her foot strong where they have been weak and hurt this week. And pray, God, you knit back together what is broken. We pray, God, your continued grace and work in Walt's life, Lord, with others who are sick and injured, with shut-ins, God, who can often feel isolated and alone. And we just pray over and over again, you would remind Kitty and Ralph and Kathleen and Judy, Pat, that they are not alone and that you fellowship with them. You hold them close. We thank you, Father, for the freedom we have to minister to children and families during the week through Neighborhood Learning Center. We pray, God, that you might protect that ministry and you might bless that ministry and you might cause it to be fruitful, Lord. It's never more needed than now in a day and age of deceit and lies and lovelessness and all kinds of sins, Lord, that our society is chasing after as we worship idols. Well, Father, we ask you to help us make a difference. We're here by your grace and your sovereign hand, and we want, Lord, to serve you and glorify Christ and make a difference. We thank you that right now, in countries that do not enjoy an Independence Day or do not have these Bill of Rights and these freedoms guaranteed to us, that your church endures and it persists in spiritually dark places like Afghanistan and North Korea, in China, where a cult perpetuates, Lord, to deify a leader. In so many places, God, where men raise their fist and shake it against heaven and think they will endure. We thank you, God, that the testimony of history is that your word and your church that you have built is an anvil that has worn out many a hammer. May that truth continue, God. May nations and leaders who hate God fall. May you cause your people to spread in every dark corner. May you bring a great harvest, God, before that great day of your appearing, when all the nations will be gathered and every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So we thank you, God. So many of those things are above our pay grade. Most likely we'll be watching it on our phones or on TV as events happen. Even better yet, Lord, to hear a trumpet and be caught up to meet you in the clouds and have a heaven's eye view as you bring all these events together to their fruition here on earth. But either way, Father, we trust you and we are so glad that the kingdoms of this world are becoming and will become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever and ever and ever. And therefore, we will not be afraid, for him who is with us, who can be against us? We commit these things into your hands, God, and pray that you might allow us to go forward in worship with hearts encouraged and filled with your strength. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to ask Rick if you will serve as our usher today. Now, I didn't pray this, but Rick tells me that to his great surprise, they are building his house quick in North Carolina. So, Rick, we should pray that it slow down, right? I don't know. You know, we weren't able to stop Terry and Joanne, and I don't think we're going to be able to stop this. But you know we love you, and we don't want that house built just so fast. But would you pray and thank the Lord for how good he is to us?
Lord, we just thank you for this time, Lord, in our service, that we could give a portion back to you, Lord. We ask you to bless these gifts, Lord, bless the givers. We thank you for each one, Lord, that supports you, Lord, and believes in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We're going to use number 678 as our doxology of praise this morning. The lyrics go, we lift our voices, we lift our hands, we lift our lives up to you. We are the offering. Amen? Let's stand together and do just that. Be seated. And children, we're going to dismiss you for their time of children's church. Sam's going to lead you out. Oh, correction. The children's church teacher is meeting you at the door and she will lead you out. That means, Sam, you can't leave. You have to stay with us. I want to thank you for last week. We had such a wonderful time fellowshipping with you. It was so much fun. I noticed not many of you used the moon bounce, though, and I am disappointed that we don't have more broken bones and sprained things as a result of you in that moon bounce. But thank you for being such a blessing to our family and for Sam, and we're just excited at the new chapter unfolding in his life. I'd like you to turn into the Old Testament, to the book of Isaiah the prophet this morning. I dare say that part of our text you will no doubt recognize because you've probably read it in a Hallmark card or a Dayspring card, or you've seen it on bulletin stock in the front of a bulletin. It was even used on the Eagles Super Bowl Sunday, because it has eagles in it. I don't believe God intended it for the Philadelphia Eagles, however, but he intended it for a much greater purpose. And Isaiah chapter 40, and though you may be familiar with the end of the text, the previous verses are pretty awesome too. Let's hear God's word starting in verse 21 of Isaiah chapter 40. This is the Lord speaking through his prophet. So these words are coming from the mouth of God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? He sits enthroned above the circle of the earth, and his people are like grasshoppers. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy and spreads them out like a tent to live in. He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of this world to nothing. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, No sooner do they take root in the ground than he blows on them and they wither, and a whirlwind sweeps them away like chaff. To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls them each by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and complain, O Israel? My way is hidden from the Lord. My cause is disregarded by my God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow weary and tired, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. May God bless the reading of his word. Lord, I pray now, may your Spirit use the word to great effect in all of our lives. Hide the preacher and exalt Christ, the author of the word. I pray in his name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to go back in time this morning. Probably further back than any of you can go from personal experience. Did you pay attention in history class? Imagine you were a citizen of Czechoslovakia in September 1938. Your nation has one of Europe's best equipped armies, and you have a strong defense on your northern frontier and a mountain range to aid in that defense. And your people are mobilizing to protect your land against a threat, a powerful aggressor to the north, led by a Führer, leader, the nation of Nazi Germany. Adolf Hitler has annexed your neighbor, Austria, 6 months ago. And now he has set his sights on your land, specifically the Sudetenland, a border area to the north and round, ringing your country of ethnic minority Germans. And he demands that it be incorporated into Greater Germany, just like Austria. You're ready to resist, but you cannot fight alone. You're hoping in your allies, Great Britain, far-off island nation of Europe, and France, you actually have a mutual defense treaty with. You have an alliance. You even have a treaty with the Soviet Union. And Joseph Stalin is prepared to cooperate with Britain and France if they come to your defense. But England is desperate to maintain peace at any cost. And together with the French, the Italians are invited to mediate with Herr Hitler in Munich and appease him. Mussolini of Italy prepares, it is said, a plan. What they don't know at the time is it was written by the German Foreign Office. A peace plan. Your delegation of negotiators are in a Munich hotel, but you are never called upon, and you are never invited to these negotiations. A pact is made. Your nation will submit to the German Führer. You will allow Germany to take the Sudetenland and swallow up your fortifications, swallow up your defenses without a shot. Or you can fight, but you will fight alone. You've been sold out. As your country is betrayed, you watch British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain return home a supposed hero to cheering crowds. You will watch him on the newsreels proclaim that he has achieved, quote, peace with honor, and I believe it is peace for our time, end quote. Chamberlain's words were immediately challenged by his greatest critic, Winston Churchill, who declared, "You were given the choice between war and dishonor. You chose dishonor, and you will have war." 6 months later, Hitler annexes the rest of Czechoslovakia as well. And 9 months after that, he attacks Poland, and World War II commences. The allies in whom you had hoped and trusted were useless allies who could not save you. Old Testament Israel is often surrounded by physical enemies. You know, God promised them a land, and he said, "You will go in and you will clear out the peoples of that land. I am giving it to you." And Israel did that work very incompletely, and did it partially, and did it faithlessly in many an account, to the point where God said, "I will not remove your enemies from among you, and they will be a source of temptation to you and a source of trouble." And that proved true all of Israel's history. A little nation in a sea of enemies. Nations that desired her land, that God had promised her through Abraham. Israel faced almost constant warfare and pressure to survive, and was tempted constantly to make alliances with foreign powers, hoping to play one nation off another and somehow survive. Vicious and larger nations, particularly to her north, the Assyrian Empire, the Babylonian Empire. And yet God, in all of that, called her constantly to not seek security and trust in foreign gods, foreign idols, and useless alliances. He called them to trust in God and God alone, the Lord God, the maker of heaven and earth. Boy, is that hard for Israel. Trust in a God you cannot see. A lot easier to bow down to something made with human hands and trust in the swords you can count and the shields before you. A constant theme in Scripture for them is this: in whom, my people, will you trust? Would Israel put her hope in the Lord or in the idols she so often worshiped, the idols of the nations that worship them too? Isaiah, the prophet, is going to frame this issue for them and call them to faith, not in her allies and her idols, but faith in her God. It's a call that all of us need to heed today, because while we're not facing physical war today, we are involved in a great spiritual war that is raging all around us. Our eyes can't see it. We see the effects, though, right? A culture that believes lies, right? A nation confusing the definition of good and evil and celebrating things that God says are abominable. Forces of good and evil are at work, and both your earthly life and eternal future are affected, and you are caught up in this world, in this war, whether you want to admit that or not. And you must ask yourself, in whom, in the midst of this whirlwind, do I trust? Do I trust in what my eyes can see and allies I think I can make, and the idols that we all are tempted so sorely to worship, right? We don't bow down before blocks of marble and gold and silver, but we prostitute ourselves with the numbers in our bank accounts and our land and our history, and aren't we Americans, and we wrap God in the flag, and You know, we are blessed, but America ultimately can't save. It is not the Messiah. In whom do I trust? Let's hear the words of God's prophet on this and Independence Day weekend, and be reminded how very dependent we truly are, which is hard for us in our pride as Americans that we are independent and we don't need anybody unless it gets too hard. Can we rely on our Lord for help right now and in the days to come? The Bible says you can. Let's hear it from the prophet Isaiah. What have you read? Well, as we'll see, you've read a tremendously encouraging passage. It comes on the heels of 35 chapters of mighty discouraging words. Because the first 35 chapters of Isaiah are messages of doom and judgment upon Israel, God's people, and the nations surrounding it. Because of the gods they all worship, the glory days of King Solomon and King David before him are about 300 years in the past. So much has been lost. The nation as a whole has compromised her relationship with the Lord. It is fairly said of Israel, she worships the gods and goddesses of the nations around her. Right? She's had kings and leaders that have pillaged God's own temple and built foreign altars within it to worship other gods. Chapters 36 through 39 are a historical narrative of the mortal threat that the nation of Assyria is to Israel, and God's miraculous deliverance of his people as his man, his king, Hezekiah, takes a courageous and lonely stand for the Lord against idols. The people aren't exactly willing to follow, at least not all of them. But the issue is, whose God is God? And in whom will you trust and hope? That is the question. And with chapter 40 begins a proclamation of glorious hope for the people of God. A glorious hope through the remainder of Isaiah's book that is going to span not just this world and this life, but a new heavens and a new earth. You're tempted to say, Isaiah must have read the book of Revelation. But you ought to reverse that and say, oh, well, the author of Revelation certainly had read of the prophet Isaiah. And the Holy Spirit who inspired both, they fit together. But Isaiah's words beginning in chapter 40 are those beautiful words that George Frederick Handel took and set to music. Comfort ye my people. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem. Why? Because Messiah is coming. It's one of my favorite songs out of Handel's Messiah. Let's pick up in verse 21. Rhetorical questions. They're coming out of the mouth of Isaiah, but they are inspired by the Spirit of God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Questions that God asks Israel, a way of grabbing the attention of those listening to his prophet or those reading these words, asking, do you not realize the obvious? Right? If we were writing in 21st century American slang, instead of do you not know, have you not heard, we would read, duh. What is he saying? What I'm about to say is so obvious, yet human sinners are so blind. Open your minds, open your ears. Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood since the earth was founded? What? Told what, Isaiah? Understood what, Isaiah? And Isaiah says that the Lord is the creator of all, the creator of creation, of all the entire universe and all beings. It's like saying this is the foundational truth out of which truth flows. And if you believe the whopper of a lie that somehow that is not true, you are set up to believe the most silly, outrageous lies in all kinds of different ways. If you believe the eternal God is not our creator, you are believing the foundational lie behind every idol that pretends to be God for you and in charge and in control of your life. Do you realize Adam and Eve's children, who were not directly created by the hand of God like their mom and dad, and who never personally experienced seeing God face to face, and who never knew what it was to live in a perfect home, a perfect environment in the Garden of Eden, a mom and dad who saw and experienced it all, had to tell their children, you gotta believe us. I can't show you home movies. There is no such thing as cell phones and video cameras and things. You're gonna have to take our word for it. There is one God, the creator of heaven and earth, and he made us directly, and he put us in a garden, and we've talked with him, and we've walked with him, and he loves us, and he is holy. Oh, we know that full well. And he is good, and he is kind, and he is merciful. That's why we're still alive. And if you can just picture, yeah, we've heard these stories before. But the world we live in is not like that, not like that garden. It's like beyond our experience. They're the first generation to face such a lie and have to reject it on the basis of faith, to believe the testimony handed down, to believe that what they could still look at with their eyes and say, well, this is so beautiful, this is so intricate, this is so wonderful, this is so obvious that there's intelligent design, that I do believe there is a God. And that he made something out of nothing. But it would be by faith they would believe that and not sight. And not just them, but their children. And their children's children. And every subsequent generation. The Apostle Paul is going to make this point in the New Testament as well, noting that creation itself testifies to God's invisible qualities. Melody, go ahead and put Romans 1 up on the screen. That namely, God's divine nature and power will very clearly be seen and understood by unsaved humanity. That every single human being ought to understand instinctively, there is but one God, the Lord. How do I know? I know it by this awesome Niagara Falls. I know it by the beauty of these flowers in the field. I know it by the deer grazing. I know it by the starry host in the universe above me. I know it by the sun and the moon and how season follows season. Romans 1 verse 20 and 21. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. Friends, this is just so foundational, right? There is obvious truth from creation itself that there is a creator above his creation. And it reveals his power and his divinity. And every single person instinctively understands it. And because that's true, because God has made it plain, they are without excuse for not believing it. They are without excuse for believing lies Verse 21, for although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. And what Paul is saying is, because people are active in suppressing the truth and rejecting the truth and embracing lies in place of the truth, their brains, their hearts become foggy and twisted so that they cannot see, even as they say, I can see. They cannot hear, even though they declare, I hear perfectly. That there is a great deception on the hearts and minds of people who are willing to look at creation all around and say, out of nothing came something. And there was no cause. It just happened. There was nothing there. And by simple time plus chance, it just spontaneously happened. Isn't there part of you that should say, what faith it takes to believe something so preposterous? As opposed to, before anything was, there is a God, the God. And out of nothing he spoke, and there came into being what is. By design. By glorious design. A globe that sustains life. Life that was made in his image and beyond that. The Lord is the creator of all, the entire universe and all beings, a foundational truth. And Paul says, yes, that truth ought to be understood instinctively and at a glance, but it is inexcusably suppressed by thankless, sinful human hearts that through that sin become dark and twisted, including their ability to think. How crazy is it? There are people that end up believing there's a deer god who made the deer, and a sun god who made the sun, and a fish god who made the fish, and an abstract god of science that believes out of nothing and no cause something happened. We'll call it time plus chance. Suppress the truth, and you are easy prey to believe the most silly lie and embrace any kind of idol offered as a substitute, something that you can rely on, something you can put your trust in to make sense out of your life and keep you safe in a dangerous world and give you hope if you think there is an afterlife. Let's go back to Isaiah 40. Verse 22, he sits enthroned above the circle of the earth. The circle of the earth. I actually think of this verse every time that, you know, there are some that want to tell me, oh, the earth is flat, or the Bible teaches the earth is flat, and I'm like, no, it doesn't. I see in this verse the hint, at least, of a circle, the reality of a horizon, which is what I think it's really getting at. The fact that, you know, at sea, where there are no trees to obstruct your vision, you can stare off, but your sight is limited, even with binoculars, to what is on and to the horizon. And then after that, you need help to see further because of the curvature of the earth, because we're not on a flat earth. We're on a globe. God sits above the globe that he made and makes all the residents of earth properly small and insignificant by comparison, right? What does the prophet say? He sits enthroned above the circle of the earth, and its people are like grasshoppers, bugs. Think of that the next time you see a bug where it does not belong, and you step on it, and you squash it, or you smack it. The rule in our house is, stay outside and you live. Come inside and you die. That's our rule of thumb for bugs. People are like grasshoppers, like bugs in God's sight. He's not saying we are bugs, but he's saying how big God is and how small and insignificant we are. He stretches out the heavens like a canopy. He spreads them out like a tent to live in. Right? There's this image of we are surrounded by a canopy of atmosphere. We have the earth and under the earth and above the earth, the heavens. It took Russian cosmonauts the foolishness of being able to go through the heavens and into space and say, aha, we have proved atheism. We looked for God up here. He is not here. I'm like, you're looking with the wrong set of eyes, oh cosmonaut. Matter of fact, Isaiah's words are in harmony with Israel's own King David, who wrote Psalm 19. You can turn there. Melody can put that up on screen. But you've heard these words, these beautiful words. The psalmist Isaiah would have known this psalm. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth. Their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens, God has pitched a tent for the sun. Yep, Isaiah knew these words. Paul knew these words. Words of David as they wrote, inspired by the Spirit of God. With the truth, God is the creator of all creation. And therefore, all men are small. He's already called them grasshoppers, right? But now he includes princes and rulers of this world as coming to nothing before God, our Creator. I want you to hear these words, and I want you, when we read the word princes, I want you to think Putin. I want you to think Biden. I want you to think Trump. I want you to put in whatever name of whatever earthly ruler you can think of. He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of this world to nothing. No sooner are they planted, no sooner are they sown, no sooner do they take root in the ground, he blows on them and they wither, and a whirlwind sweeps them away like chaff. Der Führer has been swept away like chaff. Stalin has been swept away like chaff. And whatever name you put in for princes will be swept away like chaff. What incredibly humbling words. Do you understand that? That all of the leaders of men and their power structures and their systems of control and command are nothing to God? Have we grasped that those who are powerful and have authority in this world do not scare our God, do not intimidate him, and will not ever frustrate his will in the least? Do you grasp that? Right? It is hard to hold on to that in the face of a culture that calls evil good and good evil and makes wrong-headed laws, and when it has laws it doesn't like, when occasionally, hey, you got it right. Right? You reversed a bad decision 50 years ago in Roe versus Wade, and at least you made it right. There are people that say it doesn't matter, we're not going to listen to it anyway. And might possibly get away with that. You see, this world is so corrupt and it's so crooked, right? And I'm so small and I can't stop it. When people say they're going to drain the swamp, let me tell you, you won't drain the swamp, right? Because we're talking about a swamp in the human heart that is twisted and filled with sin. There is one, Jesus, who can change and drain a swamp. Okay? Let's hold on to that and put not our trust in princes, but trust the Prince of Peace and the Lord of Lords. What does Isaiah say? He brings princes to naught and reduces the rulers of this world to nothing. And the emphasis here is gone like that. Oh, here for a day, for a month, for a year, for a decade, they build monuments to themselves. They think they're so powerful and that they will live on, and they are brought down in a moment. They are dead. They take nothing with them. They may have an elaborate state funeral. They maintain Lenin's body in a tomb full of wax. But Lenin is in hell, and his body is still turning to dust. And it doesn't matter how many flowers they surround the embalmed, encased body in the tomb with. Note how quickly rulers come and go, but they turn to dust and blow away. Even their memory fades within a generation or two, right? To give a little history lesson in the beginning, I had to hope that somewhere you remember in your high school class something about world history. And some of you are like, huh? That's all right. It fades fast. What does the Lord say? Verse 25. And this is where Isaiah's voice switches to the direct voice of the Lord. To whom will you compare me? Or who is my equal? Isaiah says the Holy One. God wants to know. Who are you trusting in? Who do you think is my equal? Right? The obvious answer is clearly no one is. Not Assyria and her gods, not Sennacherib, their king. What is going on? Well, listen, Assyria is causing Israel major hurt. It has swallowed up all of its cities save Jerusalem, and the only reason Jerusalem didn't fall was the angel of the Lord went out and put 185,000 men of the Assyrian army to death. And Sennacherib ran away back to Assyria. There are Israelites, Jews in exile already. And their tormentors are saying to them, you're here and not there. You know what that is? That's proof. Our gods are bigger than your God. And the people themselves are wondering, why didn't God save us? Why did God let this happen? Maybe I ought to worship the gods of Assyria instead of the Lord. Maybe God's failing the test. Well, God corrects such foolish thinking. You know what he says to them? He says, look up. Look up. Behold. Look to the heavens. Verse 26, lift up your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? I did. I chuckle at all the I did stickers that people put on gas pumps to say who gets credit for our high gas prices. I did that. There's President Biden. God saying, look up, I did that. Put a sticker on the sky pointing to the moon, to the sun, to the stars, to the clouds, to the canopy. I did that. To whom are you comparing me? I created, get this, right? Look at the scripture. I created each star individually and I gave them a name. Wow. Now the ones we can see and we've labeled, we give them names. So I suspect that in the universe to come, we might have to learn new names As God says, well, that's not its real name. Here's its real name. Of course, he says a new heavens and a new earth, so maybe it'll all be new. But God says, each star that's up there, I know them, each one. I've made them. I sustain them. I've given them a name. And you are foolishly worshiping the constellations. But I call you to consider who made them and worship the one who made them. What have we looked at? We've looked at, folks, a call to faith based on the truth and reality. God is the creator, and it is obvious. And you who don't think it's obvious, if you can understand this, understand your thinking is twisted and corrupt because of sin. And if the light's turning on, let me tell you something, the Holy Spirit is doing a work in your heart right now at this moment for you to grasp the fact that there is a creator. But that's not the only call. There's a second call. And there's a second call in response to the main complaint of God's people who are struggling in this world and in this life by what's happening to them. Verse 27. Here's the complaint. Why do you say, O Jacob, and complain, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, my cause is disregarded by my God? You could use a whiny three-year-old voice if you want to ask that question, or you could use your adult voice because you yourself have thought this and said this and wondered this in times of confusion and bewilderment and pain, where you've said, God, why is this happening? Have you ever said that? Why is this happening? Why are you allowing this? This hurts. This is broken. This is wrong. This is not fair. Why, oh God, you who could stop it are allowing it. And I don't know why. My way is hidden from the Lord, and my cause is disregarded by my God. In this world, God's people will have trouble, and sometimes a lot of it. You remember Jesus saying something like that? In this world, you will have what? Blessings and miracles, send me a check. Oh, he didn't say that? In this world, you will have what? Trouble. But what? Get really depressed and kill yourself because there's no hope. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Take heart by faith. The end of the story has not arrived yet, but it is coming. We suffer. We feel pain. We get taken advantage of. We personally experience how unfair life can be, right? We get lied about. We get disrespected. We get poorly treated. You feel helpless. How can I fight this? I can't fight back. The enemy's too strong. Oh God, where are you? You feel far away. Sometimes he feels far away, right? It can't be just me who feels that. Sometimes God feels far, far away. And on the heels of that is, and he doesn't care. Like the deists, God got it all started and then he went away on vacation. He took a holiday. He wound up the clock, it's running, and he doesn't care anymore. And you don't matter. And you're feeling all that. But then there's times as we feel all that, we stuff it all down, and we put on our brave, happy face, and someone says, hey, how you doing? Oh, doing good. But we're not. But we pretend like we are. But you're hurting. And you're hurting, and inside the cry of your heart is, hey God, where's my ally? Where's my friend? Where's the one who's letting me experience all this? Don't you care? My friend, if you can resonate with what I'm saying and saying, you know, Pastor Tom, you're not crazy. I feel that too at times. Then let's just be honest and acknowledge that we have those thoughts and we have those feelings in difficult times. Israel certainly did, and God knew all about it. Now he calls them on it. And he says, now, I know what you're saying. I know what you're thinking. He said the same thing to us. So instead of stuffing it, I'd encourage you, give it voice. And express it to God, not because he doesn't know it's there, but because it's going to help you to say it to the Lord. Say, God, I am struggling with how unfair this is and how helpless I feel and how it seems that evil is winning. It's not going to surprise God, right? How does God answer those things? How does he answer it? How does he answer it here in Scripture? My cause is disregarded by my God. What do you have to say about that, God? Now, do you catch verse 28? Have you read that before? Same thing as verse 21, right? Do you not know? Have you not heard? Hey, the last time we read that, we were set up for, duh, here's an obvious truth, duh. You who chase idols understand there is a creator over all, and it should be obvious. Do you not know? Have you not heard? What? Here comes the answer. It's why it makes it into Dayspring cards and Hallmark cards. The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. Okay, well, we've just looked at that from verse 21. We know that. That's what he said. But here is new information that we need battling those thoughts and feelings of, does he not care about me? Why is he letting me go through this? He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. The God who is eternal and bigger than everything. The contrast between creator and creation. Understand this. Every part of creation gets tired and wears out. But the creator does not. Do you realize you can be so upset and think, I'm never going to sleep again. I can't fall asleep. My mind's racing. Guess what? At a certain point, your body just shuts off and you go unconscious. That does not happen to God. It happened to Christ. He got tired and fell asleep in a boat and slept through a storm in his human flesh. Yes, indeed. But with respect to his divine nature, God does not grow tired and does not grow weary. And his understanding no one can fathom. We get tired and we don't understand why he does what he does, and his timing, it is beyond our ability. But I'll tell you what we can't understand. We can't understand that he doesn't get tired and therefore he's never at a loss at what to do. And I guarantee you, God is not up there going, ooh, what should I do? My plan B didn't work. It's plan C. Plan C is not working. I need a plan D. Can the angels help me out? You think that your God is too small. Let me tell you something. God's plan A is plan A. And nothing derails it. God's plan is such that he forces everything Satan wants to do and is allowed to do and forces it to work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. That's got to make the enemy mad. Good. Our enemy thought, I will kill the Christ and I will win. Right? And that old Carmen song, 10, 9, 8, 7, right? The countdown. Jesus rises from the dead, and the plan of what I thought was my victory is the nail in my coffin. Yep. That's what God is like. Hear me, church. Your God is never overwhelmed nor lacking power. Your God also does not play the short game. He plays the long game. In other words, at any particular point, okay, football fans, in the first quarter, in the second quarter, in the third quarter, in the fourth quarter, it can look grim. It can look bad. This was not a good moment. We are on the ropes. We're down. We're never coming back. All I can say is, at the end of the game, there is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords on a white horse with the armies of heaven in his train, tossing the Antichrist and the false prophet into the lake of fire, laying low all the kingdoms of this world, and bringing all into submission to our God. Yep. Can we see that in a particular moment? No. No, we in any particular moment, we don't understand. How does this fit? How does this work? How can this possibly be work for good? I don't have that ability, right? There are many a times I look and say, this is just a disaster, and this possibly can't ever work for good. Sometimes, in hindsight, with enough time, I can look and say, this is how God used this. But I'll tell you what, there are still some things I say, I still don't know. And it will await that final day when God reveals, there was a lot you didn't know. And how I use what was meant for evil and cause it to work for good. In faith, we have to continue to believe what Scripture says, that He is good, folks, and He knows what He's doing. It should not surprise you that tons of the lies that come into your head and heart are directed at the fact that somehow God is not good, and He enjoys seeing you squirm in pain. And God somehow does not know what He's doing and is at the mercy of the plans of men and demons. And I'm here to tell you, don't believe either one of those lies. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. There's the promise that faith brings home to us. God, I'm weary. God, I'm weak. It is a constant battle to not believe lies. And to hold by faith even though I'm in pain and I'm suffering. Here's the promise of my God to His Israeli exiles. Here's the promise of God to His prophet Isaiah, sorely oppressed. Here's God's promise to His saints, you and I today. And it is a promise, folks, that is not dependent on you deserving it. Hear that. It is a promise that doesn't depend on you being deserving. It is a promise of grace. Right? You need the same kind of faith that says, I certainly didn't deserve to be forgiven. I didn't deserve God pursuing me, opening my blind eyes, allowing me, helping me, causing me to believe, ransoming my soul, changing my life. And what did I do to deserve all this, right? The answer always, absolutely nothing. It is all by grace. So is this promise. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Not because we deserve it, but because He knows we need it. He's that kind of good God who knows our frame, right? The psalmist says, and remembers that we are tough as nails. We are dust. Yep. By faith, I believe God means what he says right here. By faith, I depend on it in times of distress, uncertainty, and sorrow. Like right now. Verse 30. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. You could put Christopher and I outside and say, we're going to have a race between Pastor Tom and Christopher. Who can run around the church the fastest? Who wants to bet on me? You're not hearing the cheers from the live streamers who are saying, oh, I think Pastor Tom can take him. No way. That young man is fleet of foot. You're going to beat me in the first lap? It's not going to be close. And what if we say, well, the race isn't one lap. It's 250 laps. Aha! I'm still not going to win, but I don't know if he'll finish. Because even youths grow weary and stumble and fall. See, the great disadvantage, oh brothers and sisters, of having natural talent and spiritual gifts and, yes, youthful energy is we tend to think, because of those things, I trust in me. I can handle it. And sometimes, right, something comes up, something tough, something unexpected. And, all right, let me at it. God, I'll call on you if I need help. But that's a recipe for what? For disaster. Right? Behold here the great reminder of the limitations of human strength, even among God's people. You need him more than you think you do. That's the truth. You may not believe that, but I assure you that is true. You need him more than you are thinking you do. I am still learning that, and I am not young anymore. And I'm still learning that. What I need to learn to depend on him from the outset. And not just when you get crushed. Right? Depend on him just as much in the good times as in the hard times. Don't wait to get crushed. Those who hope in the Lord, verse 31, will renew their strength. Hoping in the Lord means to trust in the Lord, to look expectantly to the Lord. Hoping in the Lord means you know you're weak, but he is strong. And that you're going to take God at his promise, that God is willing and wants to exchange your weakness for his strength. So that he can demonstrate in you, a weak person, the glory of himself. The constant refrain of the apostles was, look at us, we are nothing. But we're telling you about the one who is everything, the man Christ Jesus. Resurrected from the dead. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. Renew literally means to exchange. In Hebrew, it was used to mean an exchange or change of clothes. So what's it saying? Israel, you saints of God, come to your Lord and exchange your weakness for his strength. God says, come near to me, you who are weak and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Come to me in faith. Paul would encourage you this way. Clothe yourself in Christ. Romans 13, verse 14. Let's conclude with Isaiah's conclusion. Verse 31. If you haven't heard of any of the previous verses, you probably have heard of this one. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. I had a friend this week point this verse out to me and say to me, Do you realize this is a triad and it's upside down? I was like, huh? He's like, look at it. The first thing is soaring like eagles, and then running, and then walking. Wouldn't you have expected it to be first you walk, then you run, then you soar? But it's upside down. I spent the rest of the week chewing on that, saying, why? Why? Why is that upside down? Why did he do it that way? He's right. I've never noticed that before. But my logical mind thinks first you walk, then you run, then you soar. I realized that hardly any Bible commentators comment on this, probably because they either didn't see it or they don't know what to say about it either. But here's the best that I could find: a fitting conclusion to the assertion that the God who upholds the stars also supports his weak and weary people in exile, Israel in Assyria, and you on this earth, because this world's not your home. The God who upholds the stars offers to exchange your weakness for his strength, and here it is. At times, yes, exceptional flying, soaring. And at times, bursts of running. But the flying and the running don't require what consistent walking requires. What do you need to just put one foot in front of the other and trudge on for Jesus? You need a daily stream of grace. You need a daily stream of grace. And what does God promise us? Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. A daily stream of grace. There it is. That's why it's flipped. So that the emphasis you would land on is where Isaiah lands: you will walk and not be faint. So my friends, let's seek his grace together this morning, fresh and new. He does know your frame. He remembers your dust. He offers strength for your weakness and refreshment for the weary. And at his communion table, he bids us come and receive grace. Let's meet the Lord together. Let's pray. Well, Father, I have been tremendously encouraged by your prophet, your word, this week. And I have needed it. And I pray the same now for these your people, some of whom are walking through some really deep stuff. What do we need, God? We need a daily stream of grace. So we're coming to you this morning, Lord, weak and weary, and where we've sinned, oh God, help us to freely confess and find grace and mercy in our time of need. I invite you to work on hearts right now, Lord. Take some quiet moments, folks, and talk with the Lord. Dan, can I ask you to come to the front? Would you pray over these symbols of the body and blood of our precious Lord, meant for us?
Lord Jesus, you are great. You are good. And Lord Jesus, you have given all for us. May we give all for you. Lord, when you gave your body and your blood. You gave it all. And what you ask of us is everything. Lord, you make us worthy. Give us your strength, your grace. Help us to walk and not be weary. Thank you for your body and your blood. Bless these elements to us as we remember your death and resurrection. In your precious name, amen.
Let's sing number 305 as the elements are being distributed. Jesus paid it all. Jesus says to his people, "Behold, this is my body, and this is my blood. It's a new covenant that I've made, and it is for you. It is for you, my friends. It is for you. Though your sins be as scarlet, they are made white as wool." Let's share it together, the body and the blood. going to ask Sam, if you'll hop up here with youthful energy as we take our benevolent offering and we conclude our service. Let's pray God's blessing on it. Lord, thank you for the joy and the privilege of giving. We pray that through this benevolent fund, we can make a difference for Jesus and meet a need that you've put in our ability to meet and communicate the love of God to someone who needs to hear that and see that with their eyes and with their heart. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you will turn to number 540. We are going to conclude the worship service with this joyful song, My Hope is in the Lord. Let's stand. And your strength be on your people as we head into a week that we don't know what's coming, but you already do, and your plan certainly will advance. So I pray, God, fill us with grace and allow us to walk for Jesus, and pray it in his name. Amen.